I think Ryan Poles said it all when he went on McAfee, saying like, we were brought here to break cycles. And that's exactly what Ryan Poles wants to do. And so far, he's set this team up so well that this is the best case scenario for any quarterback that's ever gone number one overall. Usually you go number one overall because that team had the worst record in the league last year. That's not the case for this roster. Plus all of the things that Ryan Poles has done this offseason, fortifying more of the offensive line depth, especially bringing in Keenan Allen, bringing in DeAndre Swift. This is a very complete offense that really needs this quarterback just dropped in there. I think it's a wonderful learning ground for a guy like Caleb Williams. And Shane Waldron is not a guy we're talking about enough as far as what his system is, how well it could fit Caleb Williams. I did a deep dive into Seattle's offense last year, talked to even coaches that have coached against Shane Waldron to kind of figure out the system, what it does well. At the base of it, it's pretty simple. It's very player friendly. It has that mid-zone scheme up front with the run game, which really helps out the offensive line because it thrives off double teams, so you're not really leaving your guys on an island. And then in the pass game, there's a lot of quick game and a lot of play action, which is something that Caleb Williams did at USC with heavier personnel as well, except at USC, he was relying on a couple of running backs out on the field with him. In Shane Waldron's offense, a lot of the play action is set up off of multiple tight end sets, so 2-3 tight ends on the field at a time that can not only act as extensions of the offensive line, but be threats in the receiving game. Creates so many mismatches for defenses, really dictates how defenses can defend you. And then just when you think you've got the rhythm of everything, Shane Waldron calls a shot downfield and really takes advantage of and exploits those heavier boxes that he sees with the multiple tight ends. It's really a fun system, but at the base of it, it's very simple. So it's very easy to grasp. And then it builds from there.
I think you had written something about the fact that Shane Waldron and what kind of play caller he is, or what kind of game manager, offensive coordinator, his style. And you talk about the sets and the weapons that he has right now. How would you describe, like, I think you said something like he calls games, not plays, or how would you describe Shane Waldron's approach after going through that deep dive?
Yeah, there was the same kind of scenario, the same quote that I was coming away with after watching it, after talking to people. There are coaches that can call plays and there are coaches that can call games. And there is a very distinct difference between the two. Shane Waldron is the latter because you will see them trot out almost redundant looks and formations, but then start running very different things out of it. I had a coach that played against Seattle the last couple of years tell me when they set up play action, they set it up off of run plays that they actually run. He said so often there's teams that will go out there, they'll show power, but they don't run power in real life. Shane Waldron will run that against you in real life, but then he can also run 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 different things out of that same formation, and he evolves it as the game goes on. And even as the season goes on, looking at the season in totality for Seattle last year, whereas most of his stuff is the mid-zone scheme up front with the offensive linemen, you know, the zones came up front with the double teams, he'll start throwing in some gap scheme later in the season just to keep teams honest. He self-scouts the you-know-what out of himself. Mm-hmm. That was what I had a lot of people tell me when talking to people that knew him. So this is something that is going to evolve throughout the season. It's going to be a little bit simpler to start, but then by the end of the season, we're going to see some really fun stuff, but that's all in the way that he teaches and he builds his system. So it all goes off one another. It evolves, and he makes sure that there really is no tendencies that you can pick up on if you're the opposition.
Have the last couple of weeks, now that we know what position, you know, what direction the Bears are going to go, obviously at one, when you look at the rest of their picks, and it's not like they have a ton of them, but at 9, I know there's been some argument about who's going to be available and who's the most important person of need. When you look at some of the weapons they brought in on offense, are you in the team that they still need a receiver? They got to try to get one of these receivers, or do they go a different direction at 9 or move up and try to get as close to whoever they want as possible?
Or trade back. They have really everything available to them. It just depends on what teams are willing to do, what deals. I want to think about this draft class in a little bit of a different way. Take a little bit bigger picture look at the draft class itself. Yes, they only have 4 draft picks to make come the end of the month. But when you think about everything they've done with their draft picks this year, that includes Keenan Allen. That includes Montez Sweat going back to last year. you have to include those guys in your draft class. Am I saying that precludes them from taking a guy like Jared Verse at number 9, the best edge in this class? No. Am I saying it precludes them from taking another wide receiver? Not at all. But I want to look at the draft class in its totality, which also means the veterans that you traded picks for to get. My dark horse, and the one I keep saying after watching Shane Waldron's system, is I have my eyes on a guy like Brock Bowers, who is not just a tight end. This is a really big slot in a lot of ways, but he's so versatile. And he's someone that could fit into Shane Waldron's system. And he's someone that Shane Waldron would know what to do with and would fit right into this scheme that does utilize 2 and 3 tight end sets so often. Brock Bowers could round out that room with Cole Kmet, with Gerald Everett, as guys that really make defenses make some really tough decisions as to who to put on him, because he's a big dude, but he can do some really athletic things, some really versatile things, and be one of the, he could be the first or second read for Caleb Williams in this new offense. So ideally, it'd be really cool to see Chicago be able to pull off maybe a trade back and still get a guy like Brock Bowers. But at this point, I think a guy like Brock Bowers, another tight end, could be more valuable than a straight up wide receiver, even though, you know, you don't know how long you're going to have Keenan Allen for. I think with this offense in particular, tight ends make so much of a difference.
Yeah. And if you're in win now mode, you look at the wide receiver room with DJ Moore and Keenan Allen, and you're thinking to yourself, you're in pretty good shape If you're trying to attack things right now. And I know you're our NFC North guru. And when you look at, I know there's still uncertainties. We can't look into a crystal ball and see exactly how well Caleb Williams is going to play or how good this Shane Waldron offense is going to look. But when you look at the season that the Bears had last year, 7 wins, the pieces they've added in the offseason, and how they kind of fit in the rest of the NFC North, there has to be, if you're a Bears fan, some signs of okay, this could be, we're much closer to the other teams, the Packers and the Lions especially, than we were in years past.
Yeah, I mean, you're going through the cycle, right? Of this is the off season, it seems really great. And then you need to kind of put it into perspective and put it to the test in the season. I have the benefit of, getting to cover all 4 of these teams. So I look at this very objectively. And what the Lions did so well this offseason is they kept their strengths, They invested in the offensive line. They're obviously not done yet with the draft, and they've been drafting very, very well. They got 4 starters out of the first 2 rounds alone last year. I don't think you can discount them having this giant chip on their shoulder from being within reach of the Super Bowl and having it ripped away from them. This is a team that has all the motivation in the world to stay on top. They're going to have a target on their back. And then you've got Green Bay, who are young, but they were so productive last year. They get to the divisional round with all first and second year receivers. And again, they invested where they needed to when it comes to getting Jeff Hafley at defensive coordinator and then immediately going out and getting Xavier McKinney, because safeties are so important in Jeff Hafley's scheme. They know what they're doing. They're still a little bit ahead of the Bears because they had a head start. These were both very productive teams last year. I do think the Bears have made up some ground for sure. And I think it's resulted in the NFC North being one of, if not the most competitive division in football next year. It's not going to be an easy one to win for anybody.
Do you think that gives, as we kind of wrap things up, you started the interview talking about how Ryan Poles has said he wants to break a cycle. Well, part of that breaking the cycle is getting through and getting to the top of the NFC North. And that's something they just haven't been able to do. Yes, quarterback. He was mentioning the quarterback cycle as the key there. But when you look at what they've been able to do, if they don't get any farther up the NFC North, or if they don't get significantly better, do you think this is a defining year for Ryan Poles and Matt Eberflus?
I don't, because I think that you have to think of this rebuild as a 3-year build, right? So this is the 3rd year. They finally put it all together. You need to give it a little bit more time to gel. Part of that breaking the cycle too is not dumping your coaching staff a year after you get a new quarterback. It's giving that quarterback some continuity so you don't keep repeating what happened in years past. I think that Ryan Poles has done everything right. You couldn't have asked for a better foundation for a young player to come in. And it also gives the Bears so much flexibility into the future. What that translates to in the immediate, I want to temper expectations. It would be wonderful if the Bears won the NFC North this next season. Is it going to happen? Like I said, this is going to be a very tough division. that should not be the expectation for the Chicago Bears. It should be a welcomed surprise if it happens. The expectation needs to just be, all right, let's get to a winning season first, guys. Let's maybe have a shot at that wild card, get to the postseason even. I think there's room for two, even three NFC North teams with how competitive this division is going to be in the NFC playoffs, especially when you look at the rest of the field. That needs to be more of the hope and the expectation, not necessarily winning the division. I just want to make sure we're not putting the cart in front of the horse, as Bears fans like to do sometimes, because this is a very competitive division, and it does not mean that the Bears are not going to get a ton better this year. But let's take one thing at a time.
So they're not taking the North and not giving it back this year. Not yet.
Maybe not yet. I can see that. Like, again, I'm not ruling it out by any means. And I do think that that is the goal, and that is attainable, especially over the next couple of years. But you're gonna have a tough time getting there between especially the Lions, the Packers, and honestly, whatever the Vikings end up being, dependent on what happens under center for them.